Hello everyone, and welcome to another very nice game from the 2018 European Club Cup, another game that was played yesterday. It's between Ding Liren and Zahar Efimenko. Zahar Efimenko is some 2650 Ukrainian Grandmaster. He was a member of the 2010 Ukrainian team when Ukraine won gold at the Olympics, and also he competed three times in the World Cup, so definitely a strong player. And we do have a couple of nice photos here. A very nice photo of Ding Liren, also by Nicky Riga, for you to enjoy. And we do have this photo that is on the left. We also have an enlarged one of Zahar Efimenko. Now, this might actually not be Zahar Efimenko. I browsed through the photos and I decided that this was in fact him. But if it's not, sorry about that, then it's someone who looks suspiciously like him. So there you have it. I do hope you enjoyed that. Now let's check out this very nice game. It's a very nice game because it's a Rui Lopez, which is more or less a positional opening, but Ding makes it something else. But you'll see what I mean. Prior to this game, Ding Liren is on a 93 games unbeaten streak, so if he manages to not to lose this one, it will be a 94 game, which will take him only one game from Mikhail Tal's 95 games unbeaten streak record. So let's check out the game. Ding opens with e4, and we have e5, knight to f3, knight to c6, and bishop to b5. Like we said, the Rui Lopez. a6, Morphy's defense, bishop to a4, knight to f6, and now castles. Bishop to e7, we have rook to e1, b5, this is still all standard theory of the Morphy's defense in the Rui Lopez. Bishop back to b3, we have castles, a4, bishop to b7 and d3 now, strengthening the central e4 pawn. You don't get anything by going for some exchanges here, you will only make life easier for black. So instead d3, like we saw in the game, d6, we have c3, and now queen to d7. Knight bd2, and here in a lot of lines you will see a move like knight to a5 that goes after this bishop on b3 and also makes room for this c-pawn to be pushed forward. For example, bishop to c2 can be played, and now c5. Also, you will see this maneuver in a lot of lines. You will either see this knight jumping to a5 or to b8, or in this game to d8. If you remember from the Fischer-Spassky series, the Brera line of the Rui Lopez is one of Spassky's favorite. Not in this exact same position, but this retreat with the knight. Here we have knight to d8, and this is a move that was in this position never before played. So here we have a completely new game. So Ding continues with knight to f1, preparing to remaneuver it to g3 as usual. Knight to e6, and now knight to g3. And here it doesn't really do anything for you to go something like knight to f4. Yes, you will win the bishop pair, but after bishop captures, pawn captures, Ding has this very nice f5 square for his knight, going after your own bishop. So there's really no point in hanging on to your bishop pair. And if you really try to do it, then queen to d2, and now white's position is like really, really excellent. So after knight to g3, we have c5, black finally decides to push his c-pawn, d4 by Ding, and now e captures on d4, c captures on d4, and now d5. Of course, if you can make this a central break without creating any weaknesses, then black will definitely equalize the game and will have a nice game from this moment on. But Ding decides to push this pawn forward. We have e5, and now comes knight to e4. And okay, knight to f5. Now, a very nice square for the knight, attacking the bishop on e7, also pressuring the g7 square. And if you want to kick it away, you'd have to play something like g6, but that's not, you don't want to create weaknesses for nothing. Here, first c4, attacking this very strong bishop, forcing it back. You could play something like knight captures on e7 with check and only then move the bishop back, but Ding has other plans. Bishop to c2, and now comes bishop to b4. Saving the bishop, this comes with an attack on the rook. Rook to e3, this was Ding's idea, a very nice rook lift, and now comes rook a to d8, developing a rook and placing it on a nice central square. We have knight back to g3 by Ding, and now comes bishop to c6. Bishop to c6, most likely with the idea that if captures captures, this rook will not be able to occupy this very nice a7 square. So bishop to c6, now comes h4, and this move is something I very much enjoy in this game, because it's a move, it's a move I would play, and you know, if you want to win a game, you have to attack something. Doesn't really matter what at the moment you play it, but you know, h4, a very nice move. B captures on a4 by black, as now the queen and bishop were pressuring the a4 pawn, so Ding did sacrifice a pawn here, and now comes h5. Continuing to push his pawn, and eventually this pawn will attack something. We have a5, and now comes rook to a2. Rook to a2 is a very peculiar move by Ding, and if any of you have any interesting ideas on why this move was played, to me it appears to be like a waiting move. White can recapture on a4 as it is attacked three times, but with this rook to a2 move, seems like it's just a waiting move to see what black will do. And here black has a variety of options. He can go knight to f4, he can remaneuver the queen to try and get her into the game, but black actually decided to play g6, and the g6, it doesn't give black a worse position, but it's a weakening of the position, and it's very interesting how Ding will take advantage of it. First, knight to h2. And okay, we have king to h8. If the files get open, then the rooks can come into the game. We have knight to e2 now, also a very interesting move, and now comes knight to g7. And here, as now Ding moved all of his knights to the back rank, Ding played a move with the knight back twice in a row. Now comes rook to h3. So he made, by playing knight h2 and knight e2, he made room for this rook to come to h3. And now it's pretty much a critical moment in the game, and it seems that closer and closer Ding Liren gets the Mikhail Tal's 95 games unbeaten streak. He is playing more and more like Tal, as that game against Magnus Carlsen was really, really insane, and now also playing a really, really a crazy game. And it's very interesting. The strongest idea for black is to actually accept this challenge and capture with the knight here. But now you have to see that after knight to f4, knight captures on f4, bishop captures on f4, and the bishop back to e7, you can go bishop to h6, attacking the rook, rook to g8, as the king is very conveniently placed on h8, and after queen to f3, pressuring the f7 pawn, you can go queen to e6, and it seems that black holds this position, but still, it's a very unpleasant position to play, especially against someone like Ding Liren, who calculates really like a machine. So instead, after this rook to h3 move by Ding, knight captures on h5 was not played. It seems very suspicious, you know. What if he sacrifices the rook? All the bishops are eyeing my kingside like this. Perhaps the queen will come into h5 as well. Seems very dangerous, and you know, not a lot of people would actually play this. Rather, bishop to e7 was played, and now comes Ding's idea. He plays f3. Attacking the knight on e4, and now black has a lot of problems. The knight on d4 and on e5 make it very hard for this knight to retreat. You can't go to c5, you can't go to d6, you can't go to f6. None of the other squares are available here, so the only square you can use to escape is g5. But here's the problem: if you go knight g5, then you get bishop captures. Bishop captures, and now you get h captures on g6. Now you open up the rook's file here. The h pawn is pinned, so f captures on g6, and now comes bishop captures on g6. And now you have a problem. If you play h6, then you get f4 attacking the bishop. The bishop now has to move. If you move the bishop, then rook captures on h6 is coming, and if you play something like rook captures on f4, then simply knight captures, and again bishop captures, knight to g4 with a lot of attacks against this h6 pawn, you are down the exchange as black, and you will lose this game very soon. So after this bishop to g6, you wouldn't be able to counter it by playing h6, you would have to play queen captures on h3. But after g captures and pawn captures here, white would be too much up in material, and eventually would win this game. So after this f3, it seems like this knight has nowhere to go, and if instead of, as we've already mentioned here, that knight captures would have been the best idea, But it seems that Efimenko didn't see that after bishop to e7, f3 in fact traps his knight. So he saw that knight to g5 doesn't work here. He tried knight captures on h5. And okay, Ding accepts the piece. We have f captures on e4, and now comes pawn captures on e4. And here, bishop captures on a4, finally recapturing that pawn on the queen side. We have f6, e captures on f6, bishop captures on f6, and now bishop captures on c6. When you're up in material, you should always trade down. It's the easiest way to victory. We have queen to c6, and now comes the bishop to h6. A very nice square for the bishop, attacking the rook on f8. Rook to f7, and now knight to g4. We have c3. Rook captures on c3, and now comes queen to e6. Attacking the knight and also the rook on a2. And it seems that now this rook to a2 move by Ding makes problems for him. But doesn't really matter. He plays knight captures on f6. And you don't really gain anything. If you play queen captures on a2, then white will simply capture on h5. And after captures here, you don't really have the option of capturing back. If you play pawn captures on h5, then d5 is coming, this diagonal becomes open, the queen is coming to d4, and black is done here. So after this knight captures on f6, we have knight captures on f6, and now simply rook captures on a5, the rook is no longer under attack on a2. Knight to g4, attacking the bishop on h6, now comes the bishop to f4, everything is fine here. Rook f to d8, and now not even bothering with g3, weakening the king side, simply queen to c1, creating a nice queen and rook battery, and now the queen can use the rook to exchange even more pieces. We have e3 here, and now rook to c7. Queen to e4, and here, in a very difficult position, Efimenko plays queen to e4, which simply doesn't work. It's one move before time control. This is move 39, and now it's time for Ding to make his 40th move, reach time control. So feel free to pause the video here and try to find. It's not a difficult combo, but feel free to win this game and create a 94 game unbeaten streak for Ding Liren. I'll give you a couple of seconds as usual. For those of you who were able to do it, congratulations, you have just solved, a puzzle in two moves. And for those of you who just want to enjoy the show, rook captures on f7, this is what Ding played, and it was in this position that Zahar Efimenko decided to resign the game. Simply, rook captures leads to rook to c8 check. Your king is in check, and also your knight on g4 is undefended, so that's quite an inconvenience. You would have to move the king, you would lose the knight on g4, and now it is all over. You are now down two pieces, and there are no tricks left in the position. So yeah, after rook captures on f7, a very nice victory for Ding Liren, which now brings him to 94 games unbeaten streak, one more game, and he will have reached Mikhail Tal's record, and then it will take him some 110, until he reaches 110 games to reach the record of Sergei Tyviakov. But I will still have to confirm that this record in fact happened. I've seen everyone mentioning it, but I've never seen like an official statement of it. So I will try to locate it. Also, I did prepare this. This is a live rating list. So you can see how much Ding Liren went up in ratings. You can see 11.5 points. He is now fourth in the world. Very, very close to Shahrir Mamedyarov. 1.4 points, and you can see that Carlsen lost some 4.3 points, and he's now some 2 points higher rated than Fabiano Caruana. So there you have it. I do hope you enjoyed that. I would like to thank Danny McCullough, Matt H. Weinstein, David Wetzel, Paul Muller, and Chris Amico for your contribution to my channel. Thank you a lot. I really appreciate it. As usual, you can check two of my previous videos here. Thank you all for watching, and I'll see you soon. Next video is definitely game 15 of the Fischer versus Paskey series. Thank you all, and I'll see you soon.